How is everyone? I pray that you've all had a blessed week with our Lord Jesus. Firstly, I wanted to take this opportunity to thank Pastor Gabriel and Pastor Alan for giving me this privilege to be able to share with you guys from our Heavenly Father's Word. And so if you have your Bibles with you, please turn with me to the book of Philemon. And so it's in the New Testament, just before the book of Hebrews. So it's hard to find it because it's a one chapter letter. And so the first thing I wanted to remind you guys is please don't just accept what I'm saying. Please test it out with the Word of God to make sure that it's the truth. But the last thing I want to do is mislead anyone, and obviously I'm also on a journey, constantly learning from the Word of God. And so if you do find something that I've said that's not quite biblical, please feel free to come and let me know so that I can test it and change it. And so this afternoon I wanted to encourage you guys, particularly from verses 1 to 7 in the book of Philemon. And so just to give you guys a bit of context, the book of Philemon was written by the Apostle Paul, and it was a letter written to Philemon, who was a slave owner. And it was believed that Philemon was part of the church in Colossae. And so this letter was written roughly around AD 60 to 62. And so to put it in a time context, it's roughly 30 years after Jesus' death and resurrection. And so the whole purpose of this letter is that Paul is writing this letter from prison, and he's writing on behalf of a runaway slave named Onesimus. And so what had happened is Onesimus had run away from Philemon as a non-believer, and then by God's providence and his sovereignty, while he had run away, he actually meets Paul and becomes saved and becomes a Christian. And Philemon also, being a slave owner, got saved at Paul's preaching. And so what happens is Onesimus actually becomes useful to Paul in the ministry, and so Paul is now sending Onesimus back to Philemon, and he's writing this letter asking for Philemon to forgive Onesimus and to take him back, because the context of the time was if a slave ran away or did something wrong against their master, the punishment could actually be death. And so Paul is writing this to intercede. And so I'll read from verses 1 to 7. So it says, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow laborer, to Aphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints. And this is kind of like an introduction that Paul gives to Philemon. But the first point that I would like to encourage you guys with this afternoon is, did you notice how Paul introduced himself? He said, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus. You see, in the natural, Paul was actually a prisoner of men in prison. But notice he didn't define himself by his circumstance. He actually realized that if he was in prison, it's actually for the Lord's purpose. And so this is also confirmed if you fast forward to verse 13 in Philemon, the second half of it, where Paul actually says, I am in chains for the gospel. And so the first question I wanted to ask you guys is, how do you view your circumstance or situation? So let's look at two examples of this in the Bible. So if you want to turn with me to Philippians chapter 1 and verse 12. So this is Paul speaking to the church in Philippi. And once again, Paul is writing this letter from prison. And this is what he says. Now I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole Palestine and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. Because of my chains, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly. So did you notice Paul was actually in chains, in prison, and yet notice he actually says that what has happened to me has actually been used to advance the gospel. So in other words, rather than Paul being in prison, thinking, woe is me, Jesus, why am I in here? I'm just trying to do your work. He actually realized, all right, Lord, if you've allowed me to be in prison, maybe this is actually just another harvest field. Maybe it's because the whole palace guard and all the prisoners, my fellow prisoners, need to hear the gospel. And so you're sending me here to share Jesus with them. And so notice then that Paul actually says, him being put in prison served to advance the gospel. But not only that, the other brothers and sisters in Christ, seeing his example and how in prison he was still sharing the gospel, it actually emboldened and encouraged them in their freedom to speak the good news and gospel of Jesus all the world. And so how do you view your circumstance? Let's look at one other example in the book of Acts, chapter 16. And it's starting from verse 22. So a bit of the context behind this passage. In verse 16, this is the story of where Paul and Silas have gone to Philippi as part of their missionary journey. And what happens is they were looking for a place of prayer. And they were met by a slave girl who had an evil spirit in her. And she kept on following them around for something like 3 days. And finally, Paul, tormented, turned around and cast out the demon in the name of Jesus. But because her owners were using her to make money because she was a fortune teller, they got angry and they actually had Paul and Silas seized and chucked into prison. And so we get to verse 22, and it says, the crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. Upon receiving such orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everybody's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household." So if you think of the context, did you notice from verse 22 that Paul and Silas had been stripped, beaten, severely flogged? Then in verse 24, they were put into the inner cell and their feet were fastened in stocks. If you think of the situation at that moment, they have every right to be looking at their circumstance. They have every right to be complaining to Jesus, saying, "Lord, why is this happening? We've just been faithfully preaching your word and healing the sick so that your name may be glorified. Why is this happening?" But notice in verse 25, instead of focusing on their circumstance, notice instead in the midnight hour, they were praying and singing hymns to God. Instead, they put their focus off the circumstance and fix their eyes on Jesus. So you do that in your circumstance. And because they did this, notice it says the other prisoners were listening in. And something that blew me away is that all of a sudden God brings this earthquake and the doors open up. But did you notice it doesn't mention anything about any of the prisoners escaping? It means there was something so attractive about the way Paul and Silas were praising Jesus in their circumstance that none of the prisoners left. This was their chance for freedom. The doors had been opened. Who knows whether many of them could have been on death row, and yet the way that Paul and Silas worshiped the Lord in their circumstances so attractive that none of the prisoners left when they had the chance. Amen. And what ends up happening is the jailer ends up getting saved. And so the question asked is, what if the reason that Jesus wanted Paul and Silas in the prison to go through being stripped, beaten, flogged, put in the inner cell, and feet fastened in stocks, what if it was solely for the reason so that the jailer could be saved?
Wow.
So would you learn to realize that there's actually a purpose to your prison season?
Yeah.
And so for some of you here, who knows, in this next year, it could be God's will for some of us to end up in hospital. And when that, if that time comes, when you could be so tempted to go, woe is me, Jesus, why am I sick, why am I hanging? What if we actually realize, all right, Lord, because I'm your child, if you've allowed me to be in hospital, maybe it's because the patients and the other six beds around me need to hear the gospel.
Yeah.
Maybe they need to see what it's like for someone who has the hope of Jesus to be in a place that's normally associated with hopelessness. And so what if we actually changed our perspective and realized that the very prison that Jesus has allowed us to be in is actually for his purpose and his glory? And so a great example, I had a close friend of mine, his name is Christian, and he's in a wheelchair, and if you hear his story, it's so amazing, like he's been through so much. Just to give you a bit of an update, so he was born with spina bifida, which means he was born into a wheelchair, because he had a curvature in his spine. And at a young age, his mom used to abuse him, and then when he grew older, he actually saw his dad die of a drug overdose. And then he came, that was in Cronulla, and so he comes to live in Campbelltown. And in Campbelltown he became a Christian. And then what happened was, about 2 years later, his mom committed suicide. And so all of these things piled up, and eventually a year later he ended up getting depression and going through such a tough time. And there was a few times where he was trying to, you know, kill himself. But the amazing thing was each time, God actually protected him. And I remember him telling me that every time he was tempted, he was hearing the voices of the enemy and he was crying out to Jesus. When he would try to actually end his life, the knife would bounce off, or God would intervene every single time. And so what happened was, he was put into hospital in Campbelltown, and it was the mental hospital. And while he was in there, you know, you'd be thinking of his background, he has every right now to be crying out to Jesus, complaining. And yet, while he was in hospital, he starts writing psalms, and he starts leading Bible studies, and he actually led four people to Jesus while in the mental hospital. And that just blew me away, thinking he has every right to focus on his circumstance and all the hardships, and yet he's fixing his eyes on Jesus. And in his pain, in his struggle, he's actually turning to Jesus and looking for the purpose in that hospital. And four people gave their hearts to Jesus because of the Bible studies he was reading in there. And so let that encourage you to, whatever circumstance you might be in, it could be for some of you here, your workplace. You might have a tough boss or a tough working situation. And when you could so easily look at the circumstance and complain, what if you actually realize, alright Lord, because I'm your child, if you've allowed me to be in this circumstance, in this workplace, maybe it's because my boss needs to hear the good news of Jesus. Maybe the work colleagues around me need to see what it's like for a Christian to be in the workplace. And so if we turn back to Philemon, the second point that I would like to make is, let's look at how Philemon addresses the believers. So you notice he addresses this letter to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow laborer, to Athia, our sister, or in King James, the brother, and to Archippus, our fellow soldier. And so did you notice something interesting? Did you notice that the way in which he addresses each of these believers actually reveals a different aspect of our Christian faith? So if you think of Philemon, notice he addresses Philemon as a fellow laborer. When you think of fellow laborer, what does that remind you of? For me, it reminds me of Matthew chapter 9 and verse 37 and 38. This is what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 9, verse 37 and 38. So I'll start from verse 36, a bit of context. So Jesus was going around, and he was going around to the different towns and villages, and teaching and preaching the word of God and healing every kind of disease and sickness. And so in verse 36, he says, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and hopeless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers or laborers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. So did you notice then the way in which Paul addressed Philemon as a fellow laborer reminds us that we are fellow workers in the harvest. And that means we each have a harvest field that Jesus is sending us into to share the good news, to heal the sick, to preach the gospel, to shine the light of Jesus. And so the question I wanted to ask you guys this afternoon is, what harvest field has Jesus given you? And so if you feel comfortable, I'd love if you could write down, just in the next 30 seconds or so, the harvest field that Jesus has given you. So for some of us here, it could be our workplace. That's where Jesus has put you, to share his gospel and to shine his light. For some of you here, it could be your football team, or cricket team, or sporting team that you play in. That's where Jesus has put you, to actually shine the light and share the gospel with your teammates. For some of you here, it could be the shopping malls that you go to every day. Jesus has sent you there while you're getting your groceries to be the light so that people can come up to you and so that you can pray for people and share the good news of Jesus. So the question is, what harvest field has Jesus assigned you? And how can you be more faithful in sharing the gospel of Jesus in that harvest field? So if we go back to Philemon, and notice the way in which he introduces Aphia. So he says to Aphia, our sister or beloved. And so what that reminded me of is, notice the way in which he addresses Aphia, but also Timothy. When he writes the letter, it says, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. And what that reminds me of is that when we become Christians, we actually become family. Yeah. And so notice Timothy was addressed as our brother in Christ. Aphia was addressed as beloved, or our sister in Christ. And so a cross-reference, if you want to turn to 1 Timothy, chapter 5, and verses 1 to 2. So, all the T books in the New Testament are actually all together. So if you find one of them, you find all of them. So 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 1 to 2. This is Paul writing to Timothy. And he says, do not rebuke an older man harshly, but exhort him as if he were your father. Treat younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, and younger women as sisters with absolute purity. And so notice that when we become Christians, we actually become part of the family. We're all brothers and sisters, and those who are elder to us are our spiritual mothers and fathers. And so how would the way we do church be different if we actually saw each other as family? If we treated each other as though we were our very own mother, father, brother, or sister? Would that mean we go the extra mile for that brother in Christ who needs a ride home, who might live half an hour away, but if it was my own brother, I'd definitely be willing to drop him off? Would I be willing to go the extra mile if I saw everyone as though they were my very own family? And one thing that I love about you guys is I love how you embrace all the brothers and sisters as family. And that's something that's really encouraged me, that even the first time I walked in here, just how every one of you came and hugged. And that was such an encouragement to see how you guys treat each other and relate to each other as family. And so keep up that wonderful work in Jesus, and that's something that I'd love to do more in the church I go to as well. And so the third thing is, notice how he addresses Archippus. So he says back in Philemon to Archippus, our fellow soldier. And so notice the way in which he addresses Archippus as a fellow soldier reminds us that we are soldiers of Christ in a spiritual battle. And so look at 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 3 to 4. So this is what Paul says. Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. He wants to please his commanding officer. And so two things I noticed from this passage about being a soldier of Christ is notice Paul says in verse 4 that no one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. So when you think about it, our soldiers are off fighting battles, protecting the country. But we as civilians don't even know half the battles that go on. And so notice in the spiritual sense, as Christians, Paul is telling us not to be unaware of the battle that's going on. So often the danger can be that as Christians we act like civilians and we're unaware of the spiritual battle. We're unaware of the ways in which the enemy is trying to attack us and put us down and speak lies. And so the first thing is, as a soldier, are we aware of the battle that's going on? And to ask the Lord to give us that awareness, that discernment from the Holy Spirit to be open to you and recognize the enemy's attacks.
Yes.
When you think of a soldier, the two things they're most worried about is how can we defend ourselves from the enemy and how can we attack the enemy. And so the same as soldiers of Christ is how can the enemy try and tempt us? Right? Jesus, what ways do we need to ask for your protection and help to protect us from those temptations? But also, how can we go out and save the lost and take back what the enemy had stolen? And so the second passage is Ephesians chapter 6 that talks about the spiritual battle. And so most of you would know this passage quite well. And so I wanted to read from verses 10 to 12 of Ephesians chapter 6. This is Paul writing to the church in Ephesus, and this is what he says. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled round your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. So notice, brothers and sisters, that if we recognize that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it is against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world and the spiritual forces of evil and heavenly world, then you will realize the need to put on God's armor and use spiritual weapons that he has given us. And so when I think of some of these armors, I think of what it is that it's protecting. So when you think of the helmet of salvation, putting it on your head, it's protecting your mindset. So what's the enemy going to try and do? He's going to try and put lies in your mind, lustful thoughts. And so by having that salvation mindset, we're asking God to protect us from that, asking the Holy Spirit to renew our mind. And then you have the breastplate of righteousness covers your heart, so even the desires of the heart that the enemy might try to bring out. And so I'll be putting on the full armor of God. And one encouraging thing in this passage, that you notice in verse 13, there's no mention of us having to take ground in this battle. He says, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth. There's no mention of having to take ground because Jesus has already won the victory. And so we're just standing in the victory that he has already won. And so remember that the battle of the victory is already won in Jesus. And so an example of recognizing that the battle is in the spiritual, please turn with me to Mark chapter 9 and verses 17 to 18. So this was a passage I came across probably a couple of years ago. And for those who don't know, my occupation is I'm a pharmacist. So I deal with medicines. And so when I read this passage, it actually like blew me away thinking, wow, like sometimes in the Western world, we're actually ignorant to the spiritual battle that's going on. And so in Mark chapter 9, verse 17 and 18, this is the story of a father who brings his demon-possessed son to Jesus. And initially he brought the son to the disciples, but they could not cast out the demon. And so what happens is they bring the son to Jesus. And so I'll read from verse 17 of Mark chapter 9. So the man in the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought you my son who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not." "O unbelieving generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." So when they brought him, when the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, "How long has he been like this?" "From childhood," he answered. "It is often thrown into fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." "If you can," said Jesus, "everything is possible for him who believes." Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, "I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief." And so what goes on is Jesus goes on to cast out this demon. But what challenged me is, did you notice the symptoms that this boy had? He foams at the mouth, goes rigid, gnashes his teeth, and falls to the ground. What do those symptoms remind you of? Epilepsy. So what has modern society done? They've chucked a medical term onto it and said you need medicines to treat your epilepsy. And yet, in the Bible, it was actually due to an evil spirit. And as a pharmacist, I can tell you for a fact that there's no medicine now that can cure epilepsy. And I wonder why. Maybe it's because the underlying cause is actually spiritual, but this is actually an evil spirit. And what needs to happen, as Jesus actually says in verse 29, when the disciples asked him, "Why couldn't we cast it out?" He said, "This kind can only come out by prayer and fasting."
Amen.
And so what if we actually recognize that things are not in the flesh, not in the blood, it's actually in the spiritual. And so we need to use the spiritual weapons that Jesus gave us.
Amen.
So we'll go back to Philemon. So the next thing that Paul says after he greets the believers is he says to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. The definition of church in Greek is ekklesia, which actually means the gathering of believers. And so this is one of the verses in the Bible which clearly shows us that church is not the building, it's the people of God. And that's why it says the church that meets in your home. How can a church building meet in someone's home? It's because the church is not the building, it is the people of God. And this is not the only place that it mentions it in the Bible. Just to give you a few other cross-references, it mentions it also in Romans chapter 16, verse 5, where Paul, in his final greetings, says, "Greet also the church that meets at their house." It's also mentioned in Colossians chapter 4, verse 15, where Paul says, "Give my greetings to the brothers at Laodicea and to Nympha and the church in her house." And it's also in 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 19. Where Paul says, "The churches in the province of Asia send you greetings." And so these are just some of the passages which clearly show us that the church is the people of God. And so what that means is, when all you guys aren't here on a weekday, this is just a book empty building. But it's when we gather together, this is the church. And it also means that you can have church in McDonald's, you can have church in the park, in a car park. The place doesn't matter, because what church is the people of God gathering together. And so every time you guys gather together in someone's house, or wherever it may be, you're having church. And so now we'll move on to verse 3 of Philemon. And so what Paul goes on to say now is, he says, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." And this was a common greeting that Paul would write in most of his letters. So you'll find it in the epistle to the Ephesians. He says, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ." He says it again in Philippians and in Galatians. And so it got me thinking, what was the purpose of this greeting? Why would Paul often start off most of his letters with this greeting? And one thing Jesus encouraged me is that one reason why Paul might use this greeting is to remind us as Christians what we have access to because we are in Christ. So the fact that he starts every letter off, the encouraging thing is he's saying, hey, because you're in Christ, you have access to God's grace and peace from God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. And so it means when you're going through that tough time in your workplace, hey, you have access to the peace that passes all understanding, that guards your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, as it says in Philippians 4 verse 6. And you have access to God's grace. Ephesians 2 talks about God's grace saving us. But then also in Titus, if you turn to Titus chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, the Lord actually takes the definition of grace even further. And so it's Titus chapter 2 verses 11 and 12. And this is what Paul says. "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." And so notice God's grace not only saves us, but his grace also empowers us and teaches us to say no to ungodliness, to turn from worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, godly lives in Jesus. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul actually mentions grace as well. In verse 10 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, so this is what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. "But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me." So the grace of God also empowers us to be able to work hard, and to work hard in the ministry for Jesus. And to notice that we have access to this grace when we are in Christ, when we get saved. And so those are just a few examples of what God's grace does for us. But the comforting thing is, this is what we have access to as Christians. And so that could be why Paul, in most of his letters, starts off with that written to remind us of what we have in Jesus. And so now we move on to verses 4 to 7, and this is where now Paul speaks directly to Philemon. And so I'll read out verses 4 and 5. So Paul says, "I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints." So did you notice what Paul is commending Philemon for? Notice in verse 5, Paul says, in verse 4, he's thanking God in prayer because he hears about Philemon's faith in the Lord Jesus. So in other words, did you notice that Philemon's faith was outshone, such that Paul was able to hear about it thousands of miles away in prison, and was able to write Philemon a letter and say, "Hey, I'm encouraged because I'm hearing of how your faith is being outworked." So the question is, do we have an outward showing faith such that people know we belong and stand for Jesus? Remember an example in James chapter 2, verse 14, where James says, "What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, 'Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead." And so notice Philemon had this outward showing faith, such that Paul was able to be encouraged by it and hear about it. And so the question is, do we have that outward showing faith? Are we allowing the Holy Spirit to work through us, so that people are encouraged and know beyond a doubt that we stand for Jesus? And then notice the second thing that Paul commends Philemon for. In verse 5, he says, "I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints." Now, does it say your love for some of the saints, or all the saints? So isn't that interesting? That means that Philemon had unity with the church. And so the question is, are we having fellowship with the bigger body of believers? So often it can be easy for us to just stick to our gathering and not be fellowshipping with other believers and loving them. And what I love is that Paul commended Philemon for loving all the saints. And so the challenge is, are we fellowshipping with other brothers and sisters, encouraging them up, building them up in their faith in Jesus as well? And so that's why I'm very thankful for the opportunity to be able to share today and just have fellowship with other brothers and sisters in Christ, to be able to love one another and love Jesus together. And so on to verse 6. Paul says, "I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith, so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints." And so the last point I would like to make this afternoon is from verse 7. Notice that Paul commended Philemon because he refreshed the hearts of the saints. And the word for refresh there in the Greek also means to give rest to, and to help recollect spiritual strength. And so, as the saints, are we refreshing one another every time we meet up, to encourage one another from the word, to keep each other accountable, to pray for each other, to intercede with each other and for each other to Jesus? We're actually refreshing the hearts of the saints. And so my encouragement is, we will do that more and more, so that we will each be refreshed by each other, so that we can rest more in Jesus and draw closer to Him. And so let me close in prayer. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We just thank you, Jesus. Thank you for who you are. Thank you that you came willingly, you died on that cross to forgive us of our sins. And we thank you that death could not hold you down, and you were raised from the dead, so that we too can look forward to being resurrected and having eternal life with you forever. And Jesus, I just thank you for teaching us today from your word. because you are the Word of God. Thank you, Lord, that when we put our trust in you and repent of our sins and turn to you wholeheartedly and become a Christian, that we are family in you, Lord. I just thank you for reminding us not to be defined by our circumstances, but that whatever situation you put us in is for a purpose. And so, Jesus, I ask for each one of us here that you would change our mindsets, that you would open our eyes in our circumstance to see the purpose you have for us. And help us to be faithful and faithfully shining your light, sharing your gospel, declaring your word, laying hands on the sick, whether it's in our workplaces, whether it's in the hospital, whether it's actual prison when that time comes where we might be put in prison for our faith. Lord, help us not to look at the circumstance or be disheartened by it, but to fix our eyes on you and the purpose you have for us. And Lord, may your name be glorified in everything we do. So I thank you, I give you all the praise and all the glory, Jesus, and pray these things in your wonderful name. Amen.
Amen.
Well done.